Lately, we've talked a lot about board games with slow burn, games that take a bit to get going and reward system mastery. But what about those games that are fun right from the start? That's our topic tonight on episode 260 of the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast.
We're each going to share some games that we had fun with right off the bat. Then we review a rapid-fire horror party game about surviving a xenomorph attack with This Game Is Killer from Smirk and Dagger.
Before that, some introductions. I'm your host, Sean, and here with me we have our editor and webmaster, Deanna.
Hey to all my fellow cardboard connoisseurs out there.
And the tabletop bellhop himself, Mo T.
I am Mo Tuzano, the tabletop bellhop, your cardboard concierge, helping you make your game nights better.
We record this podcast Wednesday nights at 8 p.m. Eastern at twitch.tv/tabletopbellhop, and we love it when people join us and take part in the lobby, our chat room here on Twitch, even when we record on different days than Wednesday. Now, be aware, we will be taking most of November off from the live recordings. This episode exists thanks to our Patreon patrons and, of course, our sponsor, Grand Gamers Guild.
You can find detailed show notes for this episode at tabletopbellhop.com/episode260. That's 260. Links in the show notes may be affiliate links, which cost you nothing but support this show.
The Tabletop Bellhop team is here to answer your gaming and game night questions. Tonight's question comes from Tabletop Bellhop Patreon patron Paxenarian, who asks, what are some games that are fun, interesting, and engaging right from the first turn? It can be frustrating to try and introduce inexperienced gamers to great games when it takes a while for cool things to happen. What games would you recommend for those who don't want to wait through a build-up or introductory phase to start having fun?
What a fascinating question, Pax. Thanks for that. Again, Pax is one of our Patreon patrons. If you care to support the show, you can go to patreon.com/tabletopbellhop. Now, I got to say, I found this most interesting because lately we've been talking a lot about games that don't have this feature. Games that have a slow buildup, and we talk a lot about system mastery and how much better games get the more you play them, and recent reviews where we're like, you know, the game was good by about play number four. So that is definitely something that's happening. Now, as an example to call one out, not that it took till game four on this one, but Endeavor Deep Sea, we just recently reviewed this, being the perfect example of a game where the fun really ramps up and escalates as the game goes on. But that's not the only one. Like, we've talked about lots of games like this. And there's games where, like, you got to play it twice to get it. You got to play it once to understand the game and then second time to be able to figure out the strategies. And it won't be until your 10th play that you finally grasp the brilliance of that one mechanic that you barely used. That is not what we're talking about tonight.
Which is a shame. No. Yeah, it's funny. When you mentioned the topic, Endeavor is the first game that popped into my head, like, as an example that is not this. Like, I love Endeavor. It's easily one of the best games we've played this year, but it starts off slow and consistently in the middle. There's this part where it always feels like you're going to accomplish nothing. And then in the last round, everything comes together and the end result's very satisfying, but it is the exact opposite of what Pax is looking for here. And it's literally all my brain, all I could think of. I was like, but Endeavor, yeah, it's not that. What is it? I don't know.
All right. On the other hand, we have reviewed a few games lately, like Mind Up and Flip 7, which, while they may not be the best games out there, once you start, you're right into the game.
Now, one thing that I do like about Pax's comment in their question is that these types of games, the ones with the slow buildup, the ones that take time to play, the ones that reward system mastery, the ones that need a deep dive, lifestyle games. Just to go back to an earlier review, Dragon Dice, we talked about that one. We're like, yeah, you might have fun your first game, but you got to get into army building to really enjoy this game. The biggest problem with those games is that they aren't great for inexperienced gamers, and they're also not good for hooking new gamers. So they're not the best choice for public play events. And we've actually witnessed this real time at our brews and board games events at the Walkerville Brewery, where we get a mix of different gamer types, but we'll get the strangers in and we've sat them down with games we love only to have them bring them back after turn two going, nah, I just can't get into this. So we've actually got to see that. But we've also had other games. We put them out there and people are engaged turn one and loving it and then come back or ask to play it again. Or we have to go, hey, can we borrow this? Can we steal this? Because another group wants to play this game. Can I introduce you to something else? So we're going to talk about our favorite games that are those, the ones that are fun right from the start. Games that get going right away, that are fun the first play and often many plays after that.
Yeah, you're right. I feel so guilty when that happens at the public play events. I'm like, did I just do a bad teach? Because they brought the game back 8 minutes later and are swapping it for another game. And I love this game. How can they not want to play this game? But it's a lot of those, Sean called them slow burn games, are not entry level games. And yeah, I have to say, I struggled to come up with games to put on this list because apparently I am a slow burn gamer.
I like that term, slow burn gamer. So maybe if people are interested, wherever you're listening to this, reply to it and let us know if you want to hear the opposite. Though I'm not sure it would be any different than us just listing like our favorite heavy games, but our games that did require system mastery, games that require system mastery that are worth it, is probably a pretty good podcast topic we could possibly talk about in the future. Though I like the term, so we have to use slow burn games, the hottest slow burn games. That might be another one we could go with.
Another interesting one might actually be slow burn games for new inexperienced gamers. So games where you can someone started, but they really get something out of it so that they're not just struggling with SAT, the board game, all the way through. It starts slow and they might struggle a little bit, but by the time they get through it, they're loving it. And to me, honestly, Endeavor would probably be one of the ones on that list.
Yeah. And your bonus game recommendation for a great example of that, My City. But that starts off with that fun turn one, but then builds into something. Mm-hmm. I think that what scares people away of that one is the commitment at the beginning that you're like, we're going to sit down and play how many games of this same game?
All right. Well, as usual, this list is in no particular order. We just wing it and list them as they come to us.
All right. I am going to start with the game we're going to review later tonight, which I'm not going to say too much about because we're going to review it later tonight. And that is This Game Is Killer from Smirk and Dagger Games. This is a horror party game based on aliens that's super quick to set up. And the action starts right away, right from the first turn. There's almost no setup to the game. You're handed a set of cards. You're trapped in a ship with a xenomorph and you have to do everything you can to live, which should involve killing the alien, but might not. You get two cards, you pick one to be the location you're hiding and the other the action you're taking. The action's fast and furious with players betraying each other and blowing out sections of the ship and dying from alien attacks. There are multiple ways to win in this game, but also multiple ways to lose. Now, I got to say, when Kirk came to us and was like, I've got this awesome horror party game, I was like, horror party game? What? Well, it worked and it won me over. So stay tuned for a full review for more details.
First up for me, I have Go Cuckoo. And no, we're never going to stop talking about this kid's dexterity game about building a bird's nest. It's reverse pickup sticks, where you choose sticks from an upturned can and then balance them across the top, trying to make a structure that will hold cuckoo eggs, while then trying to sabotage it also for the other players. Now, this one recently got reprinted by Devere and is now readily accessible once again. Thank you very much for that.
Yes.
This is one where I can grab this and teach it to anyone at a public board game event in no time, and they will play it at least once, probably more than once, to the point where we might have to go borrow it back from them to teach it to other people.
This is one of the games I've had to say, hey, can I get Go Cuckoo off you? Because some new people want to try it.
All right, I'm going to go with Gorinto, the abstract strategy game from our sponsor, Grand Gamers Guild. Now, a few episodes back, we interviewed Mark, and he noted that this was his most sellable game, and because, as he went on to explain, in 5 minutes, he can go from showing players the basics to having them pick up the strategy, and then more often than not, they walk away with the copy of the game. And over the years, like, we found the same, because when we're talking about these public play events we host, right, Gorinto is always a hit. It takes minutes to explain. People consistently pick it up right away, and they're always entranced by the way you collect blocks. Plus, it just looks great on the table.
Next, I have The Deadlies, which is almost becoming the new Go Cuckoo. It's our new Azul. It's the game we talk about all the time now. Uno for gamers, or whatever else you want to call it. There's a couple pet names for that one now. And I've said it before, and I'll say it again, until it happens, this game has never failed. Once it fails, I'm going to have to tell you about it, but I have had this at every public play event since we've gotten the game, and it has never failed. Most recently, we had it at our Halloween Brews and Board Games event at the Walkerville Brewery, and we had two different groups totally hooked on this game by the end of the game. This is a game where people are taking pictures of it so they can go home and go shopping and pick up a copy of their own. What really wins people over is the rapid fire play, how quick it plays, the take that fun part of the game. It is kind of about screwing your neighbors, and the amusing theme just keeps people coming back for more. Well, I admit the first time around the table is a bit intimidating because there are 9 card effects to learn, but all of that's clearly printed on the cards themselves. So when teaching it, I go through the sins, I go through the abilities, and then I let everyone sit back and read their cards once. Once they've read them once, they get it. So just make sure you give everyone a chance to read their cards before forcing, say, hey, play some cards, play a set. No, I'll give them a chance to read them all. That way you get that whole thing we've talked about on past episodes where people learn different ways. So I explain it, I show them the rule book, then I let them read it themselves.
All right, well, next up, I'm going with a classic in Carcassonne. What I think hooks people right from the start is the feeling that everyone is building something together, despite the fact that it is a competitive game. You all get to watch the map grow tile by tile, and then at the end, you're going to find players who didn't win taking pictures of the finished board, bragging about their longest road, best scoring cloister, or large farm. A nice part about this one is that you can basically teach it as you play. Have a player draw their tile, show it to everyone, and you can explain any special features on that tile. Now, I admit I have shifted to a more digital preference for this game, but it still really does hold up. And actually, it's probably something that if we pulled out all your expansions, we could probably have at the public play events.
Even with the expansions, unless you're a hardcore gamer, who cares? Just ignore the special abilities. Like, ignore everything but the roads and the walls, and you're good to go.
Yay, more tiles.
Yeah, exactly.
All right, I've got Suro, and I'm going to be honest and say I do not enjoy this game, but I acknowledge it is very popular, and I've seen many people have a lot of fun with it. So I'm going to talk about how everyone else seems to be having fun from round one. Similar to Carcassonne, a big part of the fun of this game is watching the path grow, though really it's going to be the first time you play a tile that forces your opponent's dragon to crash. Better yet, if you get to crash two into each other, that's going to have you hooked. This super simple to teach game plays with up to 8 players and is fantastic for large groups as a filler or a starter. And if you find Suro a little too simple, I encourage you to try and find a copy of the long out of print Indigo from Ravensburger, which has a similar feel.
Yeah, Indigo is one. I need to put that on the menu for next month, I think, later this month, because I think that'd be a popular one. That it uses hexes instead of squares, but has a very similar thing where you're trying to collect gems. And it's that, again, the laying a tile, building a path. Next one I've got, and this one was more of the gut feeling, right? I'm looking around at my games. I'm thinking about this topic. We've had a couple weeks to think about this one, and I looked over and I saw Kapow! This is the superhero dice builder from Wise Wizard Games, and it's a comic book battle. And where this one sticks out to me is that comic book feeling of escalation that starts with that very first roll. You roll those dice, and then you place them, and you're going to start improving your character right from turn one. Whether that's gaining some what they call dice sides, because it has customizable dice sides, getting new dice, or just adding stuff to your pools. What I think is great about this one is you even get that feeling in solo play, two player, and when playing cooperatively in teams. Well, I guess it's team games against each other. I guess they're not playing out a superhero team up, I think is what was running through my head. So yeah, Kapow, it's that first you roll the dice. And then you're just immediately like, oh, now I have more chance to dodge. Now I have more chance to do this. Oh, now I have more dice. And now I'm not only just punching, I'm now punching with a Kapow kicker, and I'm defending with a boost.
To be honest, I'm actually on the fence about this one. I tend to think that Marvel Dice Throne is a better first turn dice game.
I was thinking the same thing.
The problem I think is Yahtzee makes more sense to people intuitively, whereas Kapow takes a bit of thought. To a gamer, I think you're right. I think it's absolutely first off. But for someone who's not inexperienced, which was part of what Pax mentioned, Kapow might be a step too far. It's hard to say. Right. I'm on the fence there. For me,
I guess at that point, if we're going to say Marvel Dice, we may as well just say Dice Throne. Doesn't have to be Marvel.
Well, I haven't played their other ones. So next up, I've got Quacks of Quedlinburg. Now, this is a game with a definite buildup, but right from the start, you are having fun. I don't know how many times I've seen people bust on that first turn. And the good thing is that it just doesn't matter that much early on. Losing a point or two can be totally worth the chance to be able to buy a level two or higher chit in that first buying phase.
Yeah, that's a great one. That one, people have so much fun with that game. And it just escalates and it gets more ridiculous as the game goes on. That is a game that wins people over right away, or they absolutely hate it because they hate the randomness. It's one of the two.
The one thing about Quackzy-Quillenburg, to make it fun from the start, make sure all your players have easy access to the recipe cards. That's an important part, because if you're struggling with that and have to read or reach, that can slow down that game and take away a little bit of the fun. And if you don't know it already.
Yeah. And another tip is don't put out the recipes that aren't available. When you're playing with experienced gamers, putting out those purple and yellow, I think it is, that get added in as the game goes on, makes sense because you're going to want to look ahead. But with new gamers, don't even put them on the table. That way you have limited choices those first rounds.
I'm going with Monstrosity. Honestly, most drawing games would fit the list. I also considered Telestrations and Caution Signs, but both of those have a bit of a buildup. Well, you have to explain how everything works, whereas Monstrosity is just so simple and it starts right away. One person looks at a card and then they describe the monster that they saw and everyone else starts drawing. It really couldn't be easier. And the fun starts right from round one.
Yeah, that game's so super simple. Like we just explained the whole game to you, right? Someone looks at a card and then puts it down and describes a monster. Everyone else draws it. Like, everyone gets that right from the start. Now, another one people pick up right away is Drop It, because they just look at it. And by now, Tetris is pretty much ubiquitous and dropping things to fill columns. And yeah, along with other similar games, they just see this and like people see it and like, what is that? And as soon as you drop that first piece, you're hooked. And like, I remember Sean, the first time he dropped a piece, more importantly, and it not quite acting exactly how he wanted and going, nope, I get this. And he literally said that he dropped the piece and went, I get this. And it's one of the fun parts about this game is the way they slide and the bounce in the ways you don't expect them. But the other aspect, though, is the fact there's a real game here. There's some strategy. This is a game where you're dropping shapes into a holder, Tetris style, but there's a limitation, of not being able to touch the same shape or same color, or you don't score any points. And that leads to actual tactical and sometimes strategic play, where you're deciding what pieces you have or maybe saving some for later in the round because you can see what your opponent's playing. And I love the fact that there's that much depth in what's basically a game about dropping wooden shapes in a trough.
Yeah, I think the really interesting thing for me is you need to get someone to drop a piece in. Yes. Even if they're not playing, you know, just bring them over and get them to drop a piece in first and to get them hooked, because it's easy to look at the game from afar and think, oh, connect four. You're going to drop a piece in and then you're going to drop another piece next to it. It doesn't work that way. Physics takes over and makes it so much more of a game. So that first drop really does make a difference. All right. And next up for me is Picture Perfect. I've been taking a lot of photographs lately, so I'm right on for this theme. There's just something about opening up your initial envelopes and trying to figure out how to start placing your standees and arranging the photo before you that just felt immersive, interesting, and then engaging right from the start. You really get the feel of trying to make everyone happy, and it just grows as the game goes on. And then there's the anticipation of snapping that picture at the end and knowing that your photography is what you're going to judge the game on, not, how you might have been looking at it otherwise.
Yeah, that moment where you actually have to break out your cell phone and take the picture, that it does, it makes the game.
Last time we played, I think that was the longest part of the game. Everyone was trying to get the perfect picture and angle their camera on. Like, there's some restrictions, right? Like, all you can see is game pieces and you can't be above the camera. And there's all these little rules for having to do it. But then your score is based on that picture, not how they are. So it doesn't matter if you look like that person's blocked, if you can see their face. I remember
when losing that points. Game had no AP until we all took out our cell phones. And
yeah, we were all pretty quick with the term, but. Yes, getting the perfect cell phone picture was a big part of the game.
Yeah. All right. I'm going to talk about Castle Panic. One of the things we learned while checking out the Castle Panic big box is that it can quickly suck you in, whether you're playing the base game or tossing in all of the expansions. It works because you start the game in peril, and it never lets up until you either win or lose. It just keeps escalating. It's very tense, and it does a good co-op thing where it's a close game. and you're going to lose, but it's going to feel like you could have won and you just want to try again. Check out our review to find out what we think is the best combination of expansions if you're ready to move on from the base game.
Now, based on the list so far, I started to notice a trend here while looking through it and trying to add some more to it. And I noticed there's a lot of tile laying games where you're building something. That seems to be something that just engages people. And I think that's why there's so many tile games on this list, like Monster Factories. Here's another one I'm going to throw it quick just as a suggestion, because you're building monsters and you see the monsters grow. That's a little simpler than most of the games on the list, but they seems to fit. So here's another one with a little bit more meat, the Monster Factory, and that is Lanterns the Harvest Festival. Now, my favorite part about this game is that everyone is involved all the time, because whenever you place a tile, not only do you get to collect colored lanterns based on how it's placed, but so do all of your opponents. And I love games where you have to try to help yourself, but not, and you end up helping your opponents and you're like, I need to help myself more than him. I don't want to do this move where, yeah, I get one thing I need, but I get Sean three things he needs. And I adore that as a mechanic. And I think Lanterns is one of the best games in that genre, which I'm not sure if there's a term for that genre of game. But if there is, Lanterns is one of my favorites of that style.
All right, well, Fantastic Factories is probably the heaviest game on our list tonight. And what makes this game so great is the fact that it's an engine builder that is super quick to set up and easy to teach and is just engaging from turn one. It's a game that feels like a heavier game stripped right down to its essentials, leaving something that's streamlined but still gives you that feeling of building something in the end, ending up with your Fantastic Factory.
And for our final entry, we've got Destinies. Okay. Yes, there is a bit of a learning phase you need to go through to figure out how the game works mechanically. But then once you start that initial intro scenario, you are immediately immersed into a medieval fantasy world where you get to explore, interact with NPCs, collect and use objects, improve your character, and you're just part of an immersive story, and it doesn't pull any punches. This is a game where the actions you take matter and will have repercussions later, which is made even more interesting by the fact you're actually competing with the other players to see who can fulfill their destiny first. I'm going to use that word immersive again because it's the immersive nature of this one that I think makes it a good fit for the list. You are immediately sucked in and engaged with the game from round one.
Well, that's 15 games, 5 from each of us. I think that's pretty good for our list. So, Sean, what does the chat room have to add? I've seen a couple scroll by.
Yeah.
Hopefully everyone's been using hashtag ask so you can find them.
I've seen a few in there. The first one is an interesting one because I'm not sure how I would describe this or whether I would think it's accurate. But Charlie Brown Ranger says Gloomhaven games start strong, as does Journey to Middle Earth, whereas most of the other types of games like that are very slow to build.
Jaws of the Lion?
I wouldn't say either of those games to fit the list for myself.
Not for inexperienced gamers.
Yeah, for inexperienced gamers, I think Gloomhaven is far too complicated. Even Jaws of the Lion, it is not a, like, if you're looking for a dungeon crawl, you want Hero Quest. You want, here's your four people, here's your room, roll a d6 to move. You open the door, here are some goblins, go. Like, to me, that's, like, Hero Quest would be your dungeon crawler that's fun from turn one. I didn't put it on the list tonight because, I don't know, I guess it could have fit actually pretty well now that I think about it.
It gets frustrating sometimes.
Yeah, but it's still fun. It's fun from the start, but it's not always fun. The first scenario is way too hard. The first scenario in Hero Quest is one of the most difficult ever published. And it's a design choice, and in my opinion, not a good one. And they didn't fix it on the new one. Now, yes, I find, and Gloomhaven, no one else makes Gloomhaven, even Jaws of the Lion, not a great turn fun from turn one, because you have to spend 8 hours before turn one sorting everything. Like, there's a whole, or even like unless you show up and you've got your expert Gloomhaven DM with the table all laid out and the characters all picked up and all your deck shuffled and everything sorted and perfectly organized, you're not sitting down to have fun right away when you sit down to
play Gloomhaven. It might be fun from turn one.
Yeah, maybe if you show up to the prepared, everything's ready to go. It literally starts and you start reading the scenario and go, then maybe Gloomhaven's fun from turn one.
All right, well, PAX, who asked this question is here in the chat room tonight. Thank you very much for joining us, Pax. I hope this is giving you some of what you looked for. They had jumped in and they'd gotten Gorinto, as they just listened to Mark's episode and heard his description of Gorinto being just exactly this type of game. Next up, Charlie Brown again saying Flashpoint. It's definitely not a slow burn, pun included.
I honestly, this was one of those earlier today. We had 10 games on our list and I wanted five more. And I went downstairs and I actually had my phone with me. I took pictures so I wouldn't forget them. And Flashpoint was there. It didn't make my cut of five. The last five games on the list I thought were better than Flashpoint. And I didn't want to go edit the other stuff because Sean and Dee had already seen it and talked about it and were ready and color-coded stuff. So I didn't want to mess with the earlier list. But I actually think Flashpoint's a great one. And what I love about Flashpoint is it includes basic rules that are, they call it the family game, I think, and advanced rules. And I love it because for those new gamers, you just play with the basic rules where everyone's the same. Everyone takes the same actions. You fight fires, you hack at walls, or you move. I think those are the main actions. It's been a while since I played that one. But then later you can add into the special roles and stuff like that. And I will admit another one I considered for similar reasons was Pandemic.
I've still never played Flashpoint. I don't think Sean's tried it either.
I have, actually. I played Flashpoint at the barber shop, and I completely agree. It had me hooked from the first turn. It's really an engaging game.
And one of the things, that it's got the Castle Panic thing, and it's the same thing with Pandemic. It's that peril. You start in immediate peril. The building's on fire. You don't wait for the fire to build. The building's on fire, and there's a token over there that could be the cat. Come on, you got to go save it, right?
Yeah. It's in media res. All right, I got one I was thinking about where we were talking, and it's Space Base, and I want to know your thoughts on that. Because I'm like, it's a whole thing where you're engaged because when the other people are taking their turns, you're still generating resources. Even from the very beginning, you're getting something out of every turn, it feels like. There is a little bit of a slow build, but I feel like that's a really engaging game from round one.
So I was in the basement, I took a picture of it, but the fact that the actual publisher came out with get started, quick start, skip the first three turns rules, to me means they even think it had a bit too slow a burn at the beginning.
Right. Okay. So maybe I'm thinking I like it with those quick start rules because we have been playing with those. So
where you start with some stuff in your base. I think, honestly, it's got that keep everyone engaged in everyone's turn, but I think it takes a bit to ramp into being interesting.
Mm. Okay.
Because otherwise I put Valeria Card Kingdoms on the list. But I think it's the same thing, that turn one, you're just kind of collecting resources and getting stuff. And it takes about three times around the table before you get something cool.
Start to feel like you got something cool.
You also have to pick a direction for your engine and then start moving things. I tend to agree. Valeria had popped into my mind earlier and I was like, no, it's really not.
It's hard to squeak any engine builder in there. I mean, you managed to get Fantastic Factories in, but most exception. Engine builders... Yep. Reward that slow build, right?
So yeah, absolutely. Charlie Brown's got Sentinels of the Multiverse could be a slow burn to build your powers, but more often your first couple of rounds could be your strongest. I think because of the villain and location decks, this one actually might really be one of the few card games I would put on here, this kind of card games on here. Mm-hmm. So I was thinking about the DC deck builders and stuff like that, and I wouldn't put them on here. Because it takes a little bit to build some sort of engine. But I think Sentinels could be because you can really, start slugging it out to round one.
The problem with that one is that's a system mastery game. You're going to get your deck and have no idea what to do. You get your deck, you're overwhelmed. You're like, I don't know what to do with this. That is the experience I've had with almost everyone who's played that game with me, is I have no idea what to do with this stuff. I need to play once to get to know my cards. Once I know my cards, round two is fantastic. I now know I'm the speedster and I need to get a bunch of these in play, or I now know I need to do this. And I think our experience when we played the three of us Sentinels, where we were trying all new decks all together, I think that was a perfect example of experienced gamers having a bad time with the game because we didn't know what we were getting into.
I almost felt like it was a feature, not a flaw. Like the exploration of discovering the deck was one of the only parts of the game I enjoyed, but you know.
Now, I will say, I think Marvel Champions does a better job of immersing you right away, but Sean hasn't tried that one yet.
Mm-hmm. All right. And then finally, last one we've got from the ask is Camel Up.
No, good one. Solid. I totally agree. Right from turn one, you can make a bet that first turn. And some players do, which makes it interesting. Program movement games were actually kind of in there for me. I was trying to say like Robo Rally. And then the other one that came to my mind was Colt Express. Almost ended up on the list tonight. Robo Rally came off because Robo Rally can be way too frustrating for new players if they don't get it right away.
It like can go long.
They don't rock it and they program the robot wrong the first turn is more frustrating than fun. But Colt Express, I was close. It's been so long since I played it. And I was like, I have a hard time recommending this game that I haven't played in far too long.
All right, well, there you have a bunch of games that are fun right from the start. Great for less experienced gamers, hooking new people on gaming, and for when you don't want your game night to feel like work. No system mastery needed here, though experience will help you play any game better.
Okay, I feel like we missed some stuff here. What did we miss, folks? What games do you think are fun right from the go? What would you add to this list?
We'd also love to hear your opinion on the games that we in our chat room called out tonight. Do you disagree with us? Do you think Sentinels of the Multiverse is a fantastic, you're engaged right from the start? Is Gloomhaven something that sucked you in right from turn one? We would love to hear your opinion on that. Let us know. You can leave a comment, send us an email, send a direct message, or post something on our Discord at discord.tabletopbellhop.com.
And now, a message from our sponsor.
One of the lesser known games that Grand Gamers Guild brought to North America that we personally really enjoy is the Belgian Beers Race. Now, some of you know this, some of you don't. In addition to being pretty hardcore board gamers, Deanna and I are also quite the beer snobs. And while every beer snob knows, some of the best beer in the entire world comes from Belgium.
The Belgian Beers Race is a board game where you take a hiking trip around Belgium to try some of these fantastic beers. You race around the map, trying out as many beers as you can and collecting glassware and bottle caps along the way. Go check out a review to find out why we love it, and it's for more than just the theme.
Well, today we're here to tell you about the Belgian Beers Race Dice, a new, quicker game at a much lower price point based on the original game. It is also a collaboration between Grand Gamers Guild and BYR Games and features the same artists as the original game. Who's an actual Belgian beer label designer.
This is a roll and write where you will embark on a wild, unforgettable race across Belgium where breweries are your checkpoints and beer is your fuel. For three exhilarating days, you'll crisscross the country, visiting as many breweries as you can. The goal? Savor the finest brews, collect bottles, and chart your way to victory, all while keeping your wits about you.
You can pick up this new dice version of the Belgian Beers Race direct from Grand Gamers Guild for just $29.99. And I gotta tell you, I'm super eager to check this one out.
And be sure to use our code BELLHOP, B-E-L-L-H-O-P, to knock 10% off of that. A xenomorph is loose on the ship, killing you off one by one. The goal is simple. Survive at any cost and remove the alien threat before it kills you all.
That is the premise of a new party game from Smirk and Dagger Games. This game is killer. Yes, I said party game. This is a quick playing party game for 3 to 10 players that plays in about 15 minutes, sometimes shorter, sometimes a little longer.
The game comes from the mind of Ivan Turner and features graphic design and artwork by Graphit Studio. We first got to try this game at Origins Game Fair, where Kurt from Smirk and Dagger was cool enough to send us away with a review copy.
For a small box card game, this game is killer, has a very impressive main component, a neoprene mat for the ship. Mm-hmm. Other than the mat, the only other components are cards, small ones for each location in this ship, a dead or alive card for each player, and a deck of standard size cards used to play the game.
Setup simple. Give each player a health card, randomize the location cards, and deal everyone 2 cards from the main deck. When playing at lower player counts, you will remove 2 of the locations and all matching cards from play to keep things cramped.
Gameplay in this game is killer is dead simple. You have 2 cards. You choose one to be your location on the ship and the other to be the action that you're taking that round.
Cards are played one at a time, starting with the current start player. Players choose one of their 2 cards to play and place it so that either the position part is face up or the action. If playing an action, it is completed right then, unless it states at end of turn.
Once everyone's played 1 card, you swap directions and snake back through the players in the opposite way, with the last player to play their first card, playing 2 cards in a row. Now, the second card has to be played the opposite of the first. So if you played a position the first card, you have to play an action. If you played an action, you have to play a position.
Now, note that all of this is done face up. Everything is played openly, which is important because seeing what other people are doing or where they're going to be may affect what you want to play.
Once every player has played two cards, the active player chooses a face-down location card to reveal. This is where the alien is.
Next in player order, everyone resolves any of those end-of-round actions, then the alien attacks. It will immediately kill one person who's in the same room as them. If there's more than one crew member in the same spot as the alien, it will kill the one with the highest priority number on their position card.
At the end of the round, assuming the last player hasn't been eliminated and that no one has won the game, the position that the alien attacked is going to stay face up. And any destroyed areas of the ship are covered up with their location cards, and then all matching cards are removed from the deck. And the next player clockwise becomes the active player for the turn, and you go again.
The alien wins if all the players are eliminated, and in general, all surviving players win if someone manages to kill the alien.
Now, Sean used "in general" there for a reason, and that's because there are actually multiple ways to win in this game as killer that's all driven by the action cards. Almost every card under its action lists some type of win condition, and it's even possible for a single player to win the game on their own before the game's over and the rest of the crew get to keep playing and maybe have some more winners or losers.
The trick to all of this is the action card deck. The available actions range from protecting yourself by letting you redraw the alien's location if the location you were in is drawn, to just losing it and opening fire on anyone that's in the same room with you. And if the alien also happens to be there, you'll win. There's even a card that makes you the corporate drone, where you're going to win if you're ever left alone with the alien. There are multiple ways to destroy parts of the ship, like blowing out the airlock, which has just as good a chance of taking out other crew members as it does of killing the alien.
What's well done here is that it's not all random. By being able to see what other people have played and where they are, you can tactically play your cards. And the card mix forces the game to be an interesting mix of cooperation and take that. While all surviving crew members win if the alien is killed, you have to be careful that someone doesn't win some other way. And shrinking the crew is a good way to do this.
Another thing to note here is this is not a social deduction game. This is not Among Us. You aren't all talking about what cards you're going to play and coming up with a plan before taking actions. This is a quick playing party game where you pick a card and play it, wait for your turn to come back around, then play your other card, and then resolve everything to see what happens. Okay, who's still standing? Okay, let's go again.
Yeah. There's a really high random factor here, and your choices are very limited. I mean, you have two cards in your hand, you're playing both of them. It's just a matter of which one you choose as an action. So there's only so much you can do to mitigate the randomness.
And be aware that this is a player elimination game. It may not happen. You may all die and the game may end right away. But odds are pretty good that there are some players who are going to end up sitting out throughout part of the game.
So the quick gameplay time usually is enough to mitigate that. Now, what I like the most about this game when we first tried it. So again, we're at Origins Game Fair and Kurt from Smirk and Dagger is all excited about this game. And he just like kind of gathered a group of eight people randomly around him because, well, Kurt can just kind of do that. And that we're just like looking around his booth. They're like, come, you're playing this, you're playing this, you're playing this, you're playing this. And he just kind of started it. It was just like, here, everyone's cards were already dealt to the table. Pick them up. Let's go. Like, obviously, he had done some setup. The health cards were up and the location cards were already randomized. But it was just like, bang, here you are. You're on a crew on a cargo ship. There's a xenomorph. Your goal is to survive. Your two cards are there. Here's a quick explanation. One's your position, one's your action. It's your turn. Go. Where are you? Doing your action or not? Like, the first round, I almost won the game. It was one of those cards. It's like, if no one else is with you, you escape an escape pod, you win, but everyone else keeps playing. And I'm like, oh, cool. But I didn't get away with it because someone else was in the room with me, so I couldn't sneak out. It was the card was called the Coward. Now, the next round, I think four out of the eight of us were dead because of someone blew out a section of the ship where it happened. Everyone was hiding. The next round, we all survived. Then the round after, someone who had been eliminated came back, which is something I totally didn't expect to be part of the game. So though there is clear elimination, there is a way at least once for someone to come back. Then most of the crew died. And then honestly, I don't even remember what happened after that. I just remember being remarkable how quick things got going and how engaging and fun the players were at the table were having, including us. Like there's eight strangers there. Like by mid game, I was already sucked into the fun of it. And I wasn't worried about winning and losing. And honestly, that's what I want from a party game. Who cares who won?
Yeah, it was surprisingly enjoyable. It's highly thematic and it totally captures that last man standing horror suspense movie vibe. With the right group, even if you're eliminated, which you're going to get eliminated, you're going to want to stick around and pay attention to see how it all plays out, because it's just interesting and amusing.
Yeah, while it does capture that tension and sort of suspense, it's also fun. Like, this is not a horror game, per se. While there are aspects of horror, really, you're going to walk away enjoying smiling from this game, not quivering in fear and horror.
Yeah, it's not the Night Cage.
Yes, it is not, which is also from Smirk and Dagger. Now, having played the game many times since Origins and with different groups, I have found a few things that I think could be improved. And pretty much all of that has to do with playing with a larger group. Now, our first 10-player game was a bit of a disaster, and that was because we were sitting at too big a table, and we were someone that was fairly loud. Everyone was too far away from the board and from the other player's cards, so you couldn't quickly look and see where everyone is. And that's a big part about the game, right? If you're going to blow the airlock, it's important to know who's going to be in the airlock. Or if someone else has played, they're going to blow the airlock. If your second card is be able to move to a new location, you're there, you're going to want to play it. That's a big part of the game. And it was also difficult when people were reading off their actions because, again, we were a little too far apart. I would never run this game at a long table. This is a game you want to have people kind of up close in each other's faces where you can see the cards. You want everyone maybe standing up around a smaller table with a play mat on it so everyone can see every card played.
Yeah, even just with the five of us spaced out around my mom's dining room table, we were having problems with it being too spaced out. Like, it's weird. It's not a table hog. It's the opposite. It needs a small table in order to work. If you give it too much space, it just kind of, we were even talking about standees or pawns as an option to be able to quickly show where people are on the ship to try and mitigate that a bit.
Yeah, I think the goal for this one, at least at our public events, is get it on one of the high tops, you know, get it on on a high top round where people can crowd around, and, you know, step in and out. If you've got 10 people, they wouldn't really fit all around there, but they could all, you know, maneuver around in and out, as they were playing. For some reason, standing really suits this game. Like, it's just bizarre. Mm-hmm.
I think there's also some of that, like, tension, right? You're leaning in, you're on top. There's just a, you're not sitting back and relaxed, right? You're tense and good to go. Now, earlier I mentioned this is not a social deduction game, but it does seem some people want to insist on it being played that way. And it just doesn't work as well. Like, I've yet to see it go over as well, because the key here is the rapid fire card play, quick thinking to see what happens. If everyone takes time to talk about every move, the game starts to drag. But more importantly, you're going to get into the issues that come with social deduction games, right? The way the game plays now, there's no lying to your friends because there's no talking to your friends. You're just playing cards. There's no potential hurt feelings. I only had two cards to play. I played this one. Sorry, I blew up everyone in the room. I didn't know you were here. And there's no voting or playing favorites. There's no, you know, sus. You're not going to have that come up in this game. And that's not supposed to be part of the game, which is why I like it as much as I do, because it gives you that social deduction feel without any of those pressures and weird social stuff.
Right. Like, once you start talking it out, you get into quarterbacking. There should be no quarterbacking in this game. This is not pandemic. Listen, I'm going to tell you, you can make some mean decisions here if you just want to spite someone.
It's true.
But it is impossible to play favorites. Because I remember the first round that we played at my mom's, and our youngest kid wanted to play, and she hasn't been into board games lately, and I thought, I don't know what I'm doing this term, but I'm definitely going to try to not eliminate her. And I mean, I don't go soft on my kids when we play, but I thought, I'm just going to not eliminate her because that might turn her off from playing this game for the rest of the day. And guess what I did in the first round of that game? Which I was like, that was the only thing I was trying to intentionally not do, was eliminate the one child at the table, and you can't control it.
And that is possibly a downfall of the game, right? Like, you're dealt two cards, and one's got to be your location, the other's got to be your action. You have to take one of those two actions, and most of the actions are things like shooting other people or going into cryo sleep and hiding and potentially freezing yourself to death. Or, like, there's options, but not a lot of options. Now, my final minor complaint is one I have about the components, which just goes back to what Deanna just sent, right? They spent the money to give you this awesome neoprene mat. What I would have rather had is just some meeple or meeples and cubes. Some way for everyone to mark on the board where they're located, because that would remove that whole having to look at everyone's cards, where's everyone at, or having to, even worse, go, is anyone in the engine room? Which almost every time I play, people have to ask, where is that? What is that? Like, it took me two games to even realize there were symbols on the cards. But even then, they're tiny. Like, if I just give me a meeple and a meeple to put where my guy is and a cube in front of me to show what color I am. Or even then, I might not even care what color everyone is. Just give me a set of meeples to put out on the board. Like, I'm strongly thinking of upgrading my copy of the game with a set of 10 meeples of different colors.
Yeah, we talked about Tulsi Meeples, and like we already debated in this in person. I wonder if the reason they didn't include them is because having to move more bits around might slow down what is really meant to be a lightning fast game where each round just goes.
Well, I think the slowdown is part of it. I also wonder if that sort of uncertainty is part of the game. Again, there's that whole, you know, where is everybody? And the fact that you do have to look and see, is anyone in the room with me? You have to look around and see. You can't just look at the board and go, oh, yellow's with me. Oh, yellow's Bob. Okay.
Now we just have to try it with Meeples. And if we do, we will report back to you and let you know if we liked it more or worse. I do like that. I have to look around to see if there's anyone with me. Does fit the theme really well, the way you worded that. Now, getting back to things I like, I like that rapid fire play without chatter because you get that feeling of isolation, right? You get that Alien series feelings, right? And that's obviously what this is based on. Like Kurt, like he may as well have left the serial numbers on. Like, I'm really shocked this isn't a licensed game, including the artwork on the cover even looks familiar. Due to the various actions and win conditions, you also get that feeling of not knowing who to trust, which to me is something key to Aliens that makes it stick out from just your shooting bugs, right? Like there's a corporate spy card. And what's neat about the corporate spy card is once it comes out, that stays in front of you. So you know who that bugger is for the rest of the game until they're taken out. And there's also push your luck elements, right? And there's a mix of times when you're dreading what the next card flip will be. But the other thing is the alien doesn't go back to places it's been. So sometimes you just feel safe. You're like, oh, I'm in the engine room. No one else is in the engine room. I am perfectly safe this turn. And I got to say, that's nice. Because again, it's that beat from the movies. It's that everyone's sitting down to dinner. For anyone who knows what I'm talking about, what particular scene, you know, we're all just sitting down to dinner together. Everything will be perfectly fine. And I like that. I think it's a nice touch. That is very thematic and fits the background of this game.
Yeah, they did not file the serial numbers off on this one. Their file was clearly busted.
Yes. Now, if you told me I was going to enjoy a horror party game, or honestly, the fact that horror party games would work, I'd be like, horror party game. I'd be like that. Those two, like laughing, silly party games, not horror party games. And well, this works. Like props to Kurt for knowing his audience. And again, he got us with the deadlies, you know, getting us to take something that's not our usual jam, and we ended up enjoying it. So props to Kurt for knowing the allure of his games. And I have to say that I overall I dig this game quite a bit. Like my recent plays are better. I now know some of the pitfalls to watch for. I now know how to teach it a little better. I know how to, now that I've seen the cards, and I will say, there is a little bit of system mastery here, right? Like knowing what decks certain cards are from, and like when you blow out this area of the ship, which roles are no longer around. It's kind of neat. This is a game I expect will continue to be popular at public play events. Though I got to get that original group of 10 together and split them into two groups of five, and I think I can totally sell them on this game. And I think this is going to be great for themed game nights, right? If you're doing anything horror, Halloween, Alien, Isolation. This is going to be a good fit.
As someone who doesn't like party games, this game is not for me. Like, it's not my style on so many levels, but with the right group, even I have to admit, this is fun. It's fast, it's simple to teach, and it's highly thematic.
Yeah, this is one where I feel like I should really refresh myself before the next time it's out at an event, because I can have fun teaching this game to a group of people at the public play events. Again, it's not, I don't love the party games, but I love the people who do love these games really get a lot out of it. And I get a lot out of teaching that group to enjoy a game like that. Like there's that secondary enjoyment I get out of watching that group just really connect with a party game like that.
Yeah. And it's a game that kind of benefits from having someone stand there and almost DM it.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You know, like, yeah.
So if you're a fan of Trapped on a Ship with an Alien, you should pick up this game, Ms. Killer. It's an interesting take on the theme. And one of the only ones you'll find you can finish in about 15 minutes. And if your group's anything like the people I play with, you'll probably play a bunch of times in a row.
Now, fans of competitive games should also check this out, as you're mostly working together and on the same team. But if you get dealt the wrong card, or maybe it's the right card, you could get the chance to betray someone or maybe even everyone for your own gain. It's all about being the last to survive. And if it's got to be just you that makes it, well, that's not so bad.
Now, the big one I want people to take away from this review is this is not a social deduction game. The description from the publisher even states this isn't a deduction game. It's horror survival. It's a horror survival. We're funny. So don't avoid this one if you're like me and don't like social deduction games. But on the other hand, if you do like social deduction games, I think you're going to like this because it does have that kind of feel. You've got some familiar mechanics and you've got that maybe betraying everyone else is the right way to play. If you like that, take that feel, what you can get from it, you should probably check out this game is killer.
Yeah, I want folks to know that this is very much not Werewolf in Space.
Yeah.
Well, that's it for our look at This Game is Killer. So far, the three of us have managed to survive, but the Xenomorph is still out there. So we're going to cut comms and stay here very, very quiet.
I feel like This Game is Killer took a chance by trying to be a silly party game, but with a serious horror theme. Two things that don't really seem to go together, but in this case, it worked. What's a game you dig that's a mashup of things you don't expect to fit well together? Tell us about it in the comments on social media, where we can be found everywhere as Tabletop Bellhop, one word, or even better, on our Discord at discord.tabletopbellhop.com.
Well, that was the double bell.
That means our shift's coming to an end and we're going to have to lock the lobby doors.
Before we start locking things down, let's take a moment to thank a selection of our Tabletop Bellhop Patreon patrons. Ron F. Thank you, Ron.
Brian Van Beek. Thank you, Brian.
William Fisher. Thank you.
Andrew Dacey. Thank you, Andrew.
Danielle and Owen. Sorry you couldn't join us on Friday. Hopefully we'll see you the next Wednesday we record. Thank you.
Sean P. Kelly. Thank you, fellow Sean. Well, your first stop to finding us should be at tabletopbellhop.com, but you can find us all over the web as Tabletop Bellhop, one word, and on your podcatcher of choice as the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast.
Don't forget, if you'd like to get all of the show notes for this episode, along with links to everything we just talked about, you can find it at tabletopbellhop.com/episode260.
If you have questions for us that you would like us to answer during a future Ask the Bellhop segment, please reach out either by email or just message us on Instagram.
Thank you so much for joining us today. And if you like what you heard, I would love it if you would post a review over on iTunes. And while you're there, subscribe and get notified of upcoming episodes.
That's all for tonight.
For the Tabletop Bellhop Gaming Podcast, I'm Sean.
I'm Deanna.
And I'm Mo.
Thank you.
And game on.